Hey 3DMJers, this is Andrea Valdez and you're listening to the 3D Muscle Journey podcast. Today I'm with Alberto Nunez and Brad Loomis and we're having a casual chat all about genetics in physique and strength sports. Like you'll hear at the very beginning of this conversation, this topic was sprung out of an Instagram post that Alberto made, and then there was this enormous amount of like negative, salty, or misinformed commenters who took it upon themselves to leave their two cents on this video. Now, obviously, we know that this is not the first, last, or only time we'll see this happen, especially in our industry, but we do think it's a discussion worth having, so we had it. Hopefully, this will shed some light for some people who are really quick to play the blame game. And maybe it'll give the audience some other considerations to think about in terms of comparisons, the reality of physique development, and all the things that need to come together to make a great athlete. Let's go ahead and get into it, because again, we kind of give it its own introduction at the beginning. So we'll start the recording now, but as always, if you have comments for us or feedback or whatevs, leave it at 3dmusclejourney.com. or at youtube.com/team3dmj and put it under podcast number 87. Let's get into it. Here's our chat all about genetics with Brad Loomis and Alberto Nunez.
Bert, like a few days ago, you put up a post on your IGs about one of our athletes, and he's super jacked, and he's kind of young, and everyone lost their shit. Tell me about that.
Well, first of all, I'd like to apologize to anyone whose feelings were hurt. Thankfully, the young man on the other side, he was cool about it. He was a total sport about it, and I guess that's good because he's going to get a lot of that throughout his tenure as a lifter. But yeah, 19-year-old freak. Working with Jeff. There's nothing about him that screams 19-year-old. As a matter of fact, like screams like bodybuilder of any age. He's just that good. But yeah, posted up the video. Like when I see talent like that, first thing that comes to my mind is it's the fan segment of me. It's like, holy shit, like this kid needs like a highlight reel, right? And that's exactly what I did. I put together a little highlight reel for him, and I think I'm super fond of natural bodybuilding and what some people are able to do, and yeah, took it upon myself to post it up there because I'm just super proud of the sport and see it as a lot of people, as they say, it's like, Bert, I lost respect for you.
What? Right.
That's usually how it goes. Like, I had respect for you, and then they're just, yeah. Like, yeah.
I didn't know that.
On, dude. Who do you think we are? You're insulting my intelligence. And then, yeah, that's where it goes.
Yeah.
But kudos. A lot of respect to that kid. He's 19 years old.
Josh.
His physique is
Kenyon.
Way ahead of the curve, but so is his maturity.
Work ethic, starting date, like all the things that line up to make him. Is this his first season?
Yeah, this is his first season. Yeah, he had been gaining basically for the last 5 years, he was saying. Just kind of lifting weights, getting stronger. Most teens, I think, should, to be honest. And age of 19, decided to treat himself to a contest prep.
Yeah.
Yeah, an extensive cut for sure. And yeah, there he goes. He's doing his thing, and he is a freak of nature. So that's the topic today is genetics. It's a hot topic in bodybuilding.
Hot topic because I think we're going to have to say some not nice things in this one. I know I'm going to have to – not the recliner of rage, but like the recliner of reality is what I'm going to say today.
Yeah, that's more or less how I see it. And I think the sooner you come to grips with this, the better off you are, regardless of where you sit yourself.
Right, because it's human nature. We talked about this in I guess it would be when this comes out 2 podcasts ago. We talked about like social media and how we get insecure about it, and comparison is something that's natural and that doesn't mean it's the devil, but that's exactly where everyone goes. not by anyone's fault. It's just like you see something and you think, either I could do that, or I can never do that, or how come they can and I can't, or like all those things, right? And it's like when you hear the immediate negative backlash with zero understanding of where this kid or any kid comes from in their story, you immediately are like, well, because I haven't gotten that yet and I feel as though I have worked hard, they mm-hmm. must be cheating. They yeah. must be. Yeah. And it's...
And I always take real big issue with that, you yeah. know, because, you know, who are we to judge? You know, and I mean, I take offense to it, not because, you know, I've been one of those that has been accused, but just more so those that I love, you know. And when I see Jeff and I see Berto, you know, getting attacked, you know, in various forms of social media, it's like, you know, excuse my language, but who the fuck is you? You point your finger, you know, not knowing anything about this person, you know. And so a lot of times I look at Josh and I'm like, the kid is 19 years old. You know, is he really going to have the access, you know, to what it is that you're accusing him of taking? And even if he does take over-the-counter pro hormones, I mean, give me a break. You know, it's not like that's what's going to give him his physique. You know, don't judge. Don't sit there and point the finger, regardless of if you're accusing somebody of bending your personal moral values, you know, or on the flip side. You know, putting somebody's hard work that doesn't have the genetics and doesn't have the body that they have worked so hard for. I mean, all the time. How many times do you hear, you know, do you even lift? You know what? That dude's probably been working, or a guy or gal's been probably working for a really long time to look how they've looked. And just because they don't look like your typical jacked person that has been lifting for years and years and years doesn't mean that they put the work in, you know? In my opinion, there should be. And you're right, Andrea. It's like the first thing that usually happens. But there should be no finger pointing at all, you know, in my opinion. And if there's one thing I could change, I wish it was that.
Yeah, that's a good point, right? It goes the opposite way. Like if you see someone working hard and you click on their thing and maybe they're not giant yet and maybe they don't have a huge following yet, but they're working hard, like who are you to call them a piece of shit?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Sorry, I got on
it. No, I like it. It's not me. I know. Brad swore on the podcast.
And I'd say the majority of our listeners honestly feel that way.
Yeah, I would hope. I mean, yeah.
No, and I think it's completely normal to compare yourself to others. And, you know, at the end, some people like legitimately believe that like you could grow up and be anything you want to be. And like, I'm sorry, but like no matter what, I was never going to play in the NBA. Like, no matter how much I love basketball, that was the case. Like, sorry, dude, that's just reality. But we are in charge of our own perspective. And I feel that we all are able to at least be happy with and understand and better appreciate what we have done once we kind of understand how things work on I guess in this case, like the genetic scale, you know? So for in my case, I remember the one sport that I did that I was just not put together to do was cross country. And I took it up for a year. And I remember I just wanted to be good at it so bad. There was something appealing to me about being able to run for a long time and not get tired. And I worked so hard over the course of one summer. And then once like September rolled around and like the kids that were actually good at it started to head over to practice, so bad. I remember, like the first week I was just there like, man, you're tearing it up. And I was like leading the pack and I was the one that was kind of pushing everyone. 3 to 4 weeks later, and now I know that's about how long it takes for most people to make their baseline like endurance adaptations, right? That's kind of more or less when you find out, you know, how gifted you are when it comes to that. It completely changed. Like all these like skinny little dudes that were just huffing and puffing the first week were just absolutely destroying me. Mm-hmm. And but it made me definitely appreciate what I had done, because I remember when I first started trying to get good at this, I remember like running two laps of the track and like my butt and hamstrings were just burning so bad. It was like barely a running stride. And like how far I was able to take that, it just, you know, even then I kind of understood that, like, well, you know, all things considered, you're doing pretty good. They at least let you hang out with them and they respect what you have done. But that's kind of, I wish the same perspective people would take when it comes to our sport, especially one like bodybuilding where, you know, unlike other sports, it's like genetics are staring at you in the face the whole time. You know, when it comes to other sports, like, you don't know if this dude has a 95 mile per hour, like, fastball. Just kind of looks like another dude standing in line. But with like bodybuilding, like, you know, if you see, say, a Jeff Alberts just chilling there, and this other dude just chilling there, it's like obvious and it's perpetual, and it's hard to like not get off of that in your own head.
Yeah.
If you choose to look at it the wrong way.
Yeah. Because it's not, no offense to us, but it's not super skill based. As far as like you said, with the fastball, like, you don't know that until you've thrown how many bajillions of fastballs before you know what you're, you know, where you stand amongst that whatever percent. But you know, most healthy people can curl and leg press, you know. Mm-hmm. So then it's just a matter of and we'd like to think it's programming things, and we all seek that out. And while that definitely obviously plays a fact, there's some genetic advantages and disadvantages that will overpower what we think to be optimal time and time again, over and over, forever.
That's just how it is for all sports. Shoot, one of my favorite podcasts, the Joe Rogan, they were talking about LeBron James. And this dude that is, I can't give you names, but... this guy that's been around sports his whole life, they asked him, because he's actually followed LeBron pretty closely throughout his whole career. They were like, so at what point do you think that LeBron, as like, when it comes to athletic prowess, was superior to you as a you know, grown-ass man? And like, this guy came from a lineage of athletes. Like, his father was a very good long jumper. He himself also... had a track and field background and dabbled in other sports and did it at a really high level. In fact, like, he was pro at a few sports. And it was funny. He's like, literally at age 12, like, LeBron James was like, you know, 6'5" and like running up and down the court, like, you know, a 200-pound wide receiver, and could probably like, you know, do reps with my bench press max. Yeah. And that's just how it is. And there was no program. There was no coach that like, you know, took this like 9-year-old's like, hey, we're going to do this with you. It just kind of sort of happens.
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, like, I'm trying to think of who else, like, in our sports, and when we say like powerlifting, bodybuilding, I don't think they would mind, but there are some people who we can think of that, not to discredit anything, right? Because Bert, you might be one of them. People are like, for whatever reason, they think you are so blessed because you can eat 800 grams of carbohydrate in a day and not get fat.
Yeah.
That's your genetic gift, they say. But then there's people I know, right? Right. They're like, I wish. But then there's like Encima, right?
Yeah.
Who is ginormous.
Kills the Casey Butts formula. Like, absolutely, like, just demolishes that thing.
So there's Encima, Jeff Nipper, his first show I was there.
Yeah.
Yeah. He had just,
and then you look at his parents and you're like,
Yeah, his mom's all like, could step on a figure stage tomorrow and kick my ass.
Yeah.
And she doesn't do that. Who else? I mean, Russ, for a power lifter, looks better than most bodybuilders that train specifically for bodybuilding at his age and size.
And kind of pre-Andrea Valdez days, Berto coached a gal. Her name was Paula Beasley, and her son was on our team as well. I coached her son for a little while, and Jeff coached her. And I mean, this was just a family of genetic freaks. And just to give you an idea, so Paula, she competed very well in figure, always seemed like got on stage with striated glutes. Her son won his pro card, I think, in his very first bodybuilding competition. Very good genetics, very Jeff Nippert-ish-like lines. Mm-hmm. And then wouldn't you know it, lo and behold, Brock's cousin and Paula's nephew is Cole Beasley, who plays for the Dallas Cowboys as a slot who is blazing freaking fast, you know? And so naturally, there's this lineage of athletic lines that run in this family, you know? And I don't understand why people can look at LeBron James, look at Cole Beasley, and look at these athletes and say, yeah, you know what? That's something that I'm not going to be able to do. I'm not going to be able to dunk a basketball, you know? But then these same people just fight the genetics. It's like, well, Alberto is cheating because I know that because I can't do what he's doing. Yeah. Never mind the fact that I can't dunk a basketball and I can't run a 4.2 40, you know, and I can't do, like Berto was saying, just run endlessly forever and ever and ever. The fact that he looks like he does, or Josh looks like he does, or these guys look like they do, they got to be cheating. There's no genetics that plays in the role there, you know.
Man, and what's funny too is like if we play into that in the opposite way, like Bert's seen, I think, a few of my family members. Like, I'm not some people. I do not think that I'm like super huge and giant and jacked, right? But I look like I lived sometimes, and almost everyone in my family is obese and short and inactive, and I love them to death, but I don't think they'd be like offended by any of that. But I come from like Mexican TV tortillas and sit around the table all day and talk to each other and raise kids, and like that's, and I'm not just the only one who picked this sport. Like I started when I was 6 at sports. Yeah. And so it's not like if I had not started gymnastics when I was 6 and not known, I guess not had those very early experiences, I don't know if I would probably think I had the worst genetics in the world looking at my family upward. Mm-hmm. You know, like my dad is strong, his sisters are big bone, they whatever, but they're, my dad's pretty athletic and my mom is like it's just, look at pictures of that family. Nobody in would ever think that any of them are athletic in any way. And none of them have those activities and built into their lives at all. My dad lifted at the YMCA when I was younger, but other than my dad and at some times in his life, I just would have never thought that a female in my family could do the things that I do if I didn't have those early experiences. So when you say there's this lineage or whatever, but that started somewhere, right? Yeah. And so it's on the one hand, we have this argument where it's like, just because you can't do what these genetically blessed people can do, like, you have to accept that. But on the other hand, if you see it as, well, because I have shit genetics, I'll never be able to do anything half decent, like, that's not a way to look at it either. So it's like, what are the productive ways to think of it, I guess?
Yeah. Yeah. Shoot. I mean, I get excited when I get someone who is not gifted, because I find it stimulating to, like, hey, let me try to get the most out of this person. Like, you know, the freaks, you know, for the most part, it's like, sometimes I'm like, I don't even know if I'm right. It's just that, you know, whatever I throw at Kevin Riley, it's just going to work because he's tried many things before and they work. So yeah, to me, it's, I don't know. There's something about, I take more pride in getting the most out of my people who, I guess, really, really count on me. And even, like, in my own situation, like, right now, like, man, almost 2 decades of training, like, there's really no way that I'm going to just take this quantum leap and, you know, over the next decade, like, put on 10 pounds of muscle. Like, no, it's not going to happen. And to me, like, it's the challenge of making the most out of my situation that I find, that I find the most rewarding. Like, the little things that I do have that kind of go my way, like, I don't really take pride in those. But when it comes to, you know, like this last prep, like my body gives everything away, like fat for sure, but also muscle. And like the fact that I was able to salvage more muscle than any other prep, like to me, that mattered just as much as any, like whatever I did in terms of fat loss. So I think that's why it's important to know thyself, because you're better able to appreciate yourself and what you have done.
Yeah. That's refreshing to hear you say. I think we talked about in your bulking podcast too, that like you have to work really, really, really fucking hard for what you have. Like, people don't, you're not there with everybody.
Mm-hmm.
I know we say like, oh, it's snippets, I want to see his program, but it's not just the program, not just you, but any, like, again, like an NCMA or this kid, Josh, like,
yeah.
Like it's as far as like a thing you like to talk about, like a work ethic, like your intensity in the gym, your focus, how close you get to failure, how you handle that.
Showing up.
Yeah, just showing up. But I think a lot of people think, well, I go to the gym 6 days a week. He trains 6 days a week. Therefore, I will get the same thing. Like there's, you can have people on the exact, and I know that we've all seen this with our athletes. Mm-hmm. Like you can have a very similar program with the same two athletes, but the way it's executed really matters.
Absolutely.
Yeah, and that's what we almost talked about. This one was like the work ethic in the gym. You can coast in a 15 rep set, or you can probably take it to 25 if you really wanted. Like mm-hmm. those are, when the weight's light enough, like those are the kind of things that you don't think matter, but they do. So there's a certain amount of personality trait, I guess, to that too, or.
Yeah. And some of the freaky, freaky, freaky people that, you know, you just can't believe are that blessed, that's something that they come with. That's something that I will see over and over. I've seen very few people who are just that out there relative to everyone else, who don't have all those traits you just mentioned. Like they will do things that most people would see as obsessive or not worth the trouble. Like, shoot, no one knows it, man. Like I ran out of protein at some point when I was in Columbus, and I walked 2 miles to the closest gas station in like blistering cold so I could get my protein drink before going to bed, you know? like in isolation, would that have made a difference? But it's more so like what drives you to do that consistently that matters. And I think, when people see people like Josh, the 19-year-old, it almost makes him not want to do that, when it should almost be the other way around. It should be like, holy crap, I didn't know that the human body could do this naturally. This is inspiration in that, shoot, maybe I can do things that I didn't imagine I could do with myself and on my own relative scale. Like it should make you want to do that.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. One of my favorites is Matt too, Ogus. Like I know that, I think right now he's seen as like a more of a public figure, right, than the athlete that he is. But for those of, you know, I know especially you and I, Bert, have trained with him tons and tons of times. He fucking trains, you know what I mean? And everyone's like, no, natty, da da, or like, must be nice, or he's been lifting for a long time. He doesn't just lift for a long time. That dude lifts hard. And that dude lifts for like 3 or 4 hours a day. And he takes it very seriously. And he puts the work in every single set. His warm up takes forever. And again, not that you have to do every single one of those things, but that's one of those where people accuse him and it's just like, y'all have no idea. And again, you can do his online program or whatever, but I know that he has programs online that you can buy or whatever, and if he runs them at the same time, great. But there's a certain level of intensity and focus and routine and vigor and that he literally brings to the gym every single day. Like that's his place. You can tell that that's his place. And I think that gets underappreciated when, again, people say, well, I'm doing the same program. Why don't I look like him?
Mm-hmm. Well, and you know, that's the culmination of a lot of things coming together to make a really stellar athlete, right?
Yeah.
I know there is a quote that was made about Walter Payton, who was a great running back back in the 80s, where, you know, you took this genetically blessed guy that, you know, was jacked, he was fast, and then you put that with the work ethic where he would run endlessly up these hills just over and over and over and over and over again, and you put all those things together and you get not Walter Payton, you get Sweetness. And that was his nickname. So you put all those things together, right? You get Sweetness. And so a lot of times, I mean, there's a lot of people that are out there that I know that are God-given gifts are for bodybuilding or for powerlifting or football or this or that or whatever, but they just never got all of those things coincided together. There's a lot of athletes out there that should be competing at a very high level, and maybe they just don't have the work ethic, mm-hmm. you know what I mean, to put the work in every single day and to be smart about their training, et cetera. They've got the genetic ability, but they don't have the work ethic. And then you've got the flip side of that. My son talks about this all the time. I tell him, you know, I'd love to take this program and put it with all of your teammates, you know? And he's like, yeah, you know what? They're too lazy. They wouldn't do it. Mm-hmm. And he gets frustrated because he's got kids on his team that don't train like he does. And they're either equal to his ability or better, you know? And so he's got the work ethic, but he doesn't necessarily have, you know, the abs like so-and-so has and they were born with. You know, and this kid's got this naturally strong bench press, and this kid's just naturally got a 5 second 40, you know. So how many of us that are out there that have one of those aspects that make Sweetness? You know, we've got the work ethic, but we don't have the nice lines of the bodybuilder and the small waist and, you know, the little short appendages and things like that. And then you've got the people that have the nice lines and they got the short appendages, they got the nice muscle bellies, but yeah, they like to eat too much. Or they don't like to, like to lift weights because they're too heavy.
Yeah.
So you get the culmination of things, and you get Sweetness. You get Alberto Nunez. You get Jeff Alberts. You get Encima. You get all those folks that are, you know, dare I say,
elite. Dude, there's so many other things too. I don't know if this is really on topic, but the Winter Olympics gets me every time because it gets me every time, and it just happened because I was having this conversation with LS was here. We're watching figure skating and snowboarding, right? And we were
Ellis McLean, who is a freak himself.
Yeah, yeah. Mm-hmm. Who is a genetic freak? He's a world champion. He'll
catch up with his bench press. Like no one does that.
Yeah, but we were here. It was like 2 weeks or whenever the Olympics. What, like 3 weeks ago, something like that. And we were saying how like we were watching the girls snowboarding, and the girl that won, Chloe Kim or whatever. Easily 5 times better than every other girl that was doing it. It was like all like it was this girl, like maybe 5 notches, then 2nd through 5th place, and then it like slowly tapered off. But it was like she was so much better. And I'm like, how the hell does this happen at the elite level? How do you, and same with Shaun White, like how do you get someone that isn't like ever even fighting for a second? You know? We're talking about how, well, it's when you have a sport that is easy, like if we say snowboarding versus skateboarding, right? They're both board sports, right? But a skateboard costs $100 at the most. You can do it on any in any parking lot. You most of the time, you know, you can get a cheap one if you need it. Like the cost of skateboarding versus the things that have to go right for you to snowboard, meaning you have to live in an environment like that. The clothes you have, the jacket you wear to snowboard costs more than a skateboard. You know what I mean? Never mind the board itself and the boots and the like goggles and the whatever.
Goggles and the gloves.
And how do you get access to a freaking half pipe? And how do you have parents that will take you there at a young age? And so like the amount of, so it's just like there's this playing field, but and when you say there's work ethic and then there's genetics, but there's also like luck component to a lot of sports. Yeah. Like, do you have access to these things? And then it's like if you're in any major city, like I'm in Austin, Texas. I don't know how many tons and tons of little skateboard kids live here, and some of them might make it, whatever. But I don't know. I would be very surprised if you told me like there were 2 kids pursuing snowboarding right now of all the kids that live in this metropolitan area, you know? And so it's like when the group that you're there, the possible number of people that could even have access to be good at this sport is so small then you get those big disparities, right? And I realized that bodybuilding powerlifting is like way on this like low income and opportunity, because almost everywhere has weights, right? Whatever. Mm-hmm. But it's, I think I'm just talking to my homies about how it's not just those things. There's like a lot of other things that can, coaching too, right? I mean, where do you find a snowboarding coach even if there is snow? Or where do you, you know, maybe I could, maybe I'm a kid who doesn't have, I live in a country and the internet access isn't as easily available as all these American kids that can go to a $10 Planet Fitness and start bodybuilding. Like, I don't, so there's just a lot of things that it's, I don't know. There's just a lot of other things that we don't consider when we see an Instagram picture, like, nah, it's not real. It's like, really? There's so many things that have happened in this person's life.
Yeah, shoot, influences go right. Influences when they're growing up, too.
Do what?
I was just saying influences when they're growing up.
Yeah, are your parents supportive of any of this shit?
Yeah, I mean, that one girl that, that was obviously above the rest on the snowboarding, maybe she got exposed to that at a very young age and was like, wow, that is awesome. That's what I want to do. You know, how many people don't ever find out what they're good at, you know?
Yeah. What were you saying, Bert?
No, it's like, and when all those things, a bunch of things, like in the ideal fashion, you get some really, really crazy stuff that it's very hard for people to relate to. It's, and I guess the difference with our sport is, you know, like most people who are fans of football don't necessarily play football. Maybe they did at some point, but, you know, they kick back on a Sunday and they just, you know, they have their beer and they're watching their sport. And it's okay that that dude can run like a 4.240, like no problem with that. But when it comes to our sport, it's like most of the people who follow it participate in it. And I think that really throws a wrench at the situation, because that's not only do they like kind of do it, but they like really, really like do it. So it's not a surprise that we get a lot of situations like this.
Yeah, that's a good point. So somewhere in the road for most people watching American football, there was a time, usually between like 15 and 25, they're like, I'm not going to be in the NFL. Therefore, I'll enjoy it for what it is and be excited for those freaks that are in it. Whereas in bodybuilding, you could technically keep going forever, and because you're not where they are, you assume that they're doing something wrong. They're cheating.
And it's even more obvious, like in basketball, you know, eventually you love basketball as a kid, but you grow up and you stop growing at 5'8", 5'9", you know, 5'10". Yeah. I'm not going to be an NBA player. That's, they're accepting of that. And this kind of circles around what we're talking about before. They're not accusing all the other professional basketball players of cheating. You know, they're not accusing them of taking something to, you know, make their height better. They're not accusing NFL players of, you know, taking whatever they're not accusing them of cheating. They just know, and they're accepting of the fact that their God-given ability got them 6'6", you know, 6'5" and 300 pounds. But yet, you know, because everybody participates in bodybuilding, it seems like, well, they're not accepting of the fact that Josh can look like that and just have it be that way. Have that be his God-given talent, you know. He's got to be cheating. Berto, you have to be cheating, you know. Jeff, you have to be cheating because I can't do that, you know. They're not as accepting.
Shoot, I went on a Wilt Chamberlain kick a while back, and it was insane. Like, so the guy was 7 feet tall. 7 feet tall. Usually when you're 7 feet tall, it comes with, like, lackluster coordination. He high-jumped at the collegiate level. He could run. They were running the 100-yard dash at that point in under 11 seconds. Like how insane is that? Like, there's a video of him blocking a shot, which he would catch them. That's how he would do it. And his arms, like, over the backboard. Like, how does that happen? And like, fast forward it to, like, more recent times, there was this one scene where he's shaking Shaquille O'Neal's hand. And Shaquille's, like, one of the most imposing players, like, athletes just ever. Like, just huge, coordinated, strong, total monster. And it's hilarious because Wilt makes him look like kind of sort of a dweeb. Like, he shakes the kid's hand and he almost rips his arm out the socket. So just like when you think you've seen it all, because I've always thought of Shaq as, like, wow, like, that's insane. Like such a, cause before he got to be like overweight Shaq that we kind of, you know, great athlete, but we kind of joked about, like he was a very athletic kid that could like run the floor. Like he was 4 inches shorter than he actually was. He was super coordinated. Can never shoot free throws, but that's besides the point. But here's Wilt, who's like, was a notch above that. Like, that's just how it is. It's like I remember Cynthia Weldon's pictures when I first got her pictures.
Yeah.
I thought that was, I'm like, someone's like messing with me. How is this 15-year-old girl? Like literally, I didn't believe until I had her on the phone and I'm like, holy crap, you are 15 years old. Can I talk to your parents? You know,
mm-hmm.
Yeah, like pulling 385 at the age of 17 for like 10 reps.
I remember the first mashup we had when I moved to California, and Brandon and I were just friends at the time, and we went together, and I saw Cynthia squatting at the gym, and Brandon comes up, maybe it was you that told her something, like he needed to squat or whatever, and she was squatting, and he worked, someone was like, you could just work in over here. I think it might have been Arnold, like Cynthia's brother, and Brandon was like, what? So Brandon was a 22-year-old male, and she was a 15-year-old girl, and they worked in to the same squat weight, and then she kept going, and he was so upset. He was so upset. I probably shouldn't have said that, but I remember how. And what's interesting to note, too, of the Weldons, by the way, we coach. Did Isabel work with us yet? Not directly. She works with Arnold. So there's Cynthia Arnold, who's one of Jeff's longtime clients, and then their other sister lifts weights as well, and Arnold's a gifted bodybuilder. Yeah. Isabel's grown a lot in the past couple years, but Cynthia, the youngest of them, was by far a genetic anomaly. I think they have like 5 siblings, right? But that's prime example of like there's just some shit we can't control. Granted, she got into lifting when she was younger because her big brother helped her in the garage or whatever, but if you've seen her physique too, and she won her pro card in bodybuilding at the age of 16.
Yeah, somewhere around there. Yeah, she won that NGA overall.
Yeah. So I mean, man, I totally.
And she got accused a lot too, and it kind of blows me away sometimes. Where it's like, you know what? You're accusing a 15-year-old girl of taking stuff. 15 years old. This is when you talk to a 15-year-old girl, they're not thinking about taking stuff. They're not thinking about any of that. They're thinking about fitting in at school, you know, and things like that. And then, and that's where I get that fatherly, just irateness comes out of me. It's like, you know what? Just be careful who you're talking about there.
Yeah, but there's nothing. I mean, what's this podcast for, right? Just to discuss it, right? Because when we say like, what are tactical things? Like Bert, it was good to hear you say, like, which is true, like everyone's like, oh, Nunez is the natty bodybuilder, but when you're like, I'm not gonna magically gain 10 pounds of muscle this year and sweep worlds for everyone that's there, like you know that, and it's like, does nobody else know that? But you know that.
And I scale my expectations to that, and it makes it so much more. And I don't put limits on myself necessarily. I just kind of, I have a firm understanding. I'm just self-aware. That's all that is.
Yeah.
And it's just, so much of it is, I guess it's an intellectual battle at this point. It's intellectually stimulating to get, like a lot of people will ask, so 18th year of bodybuilding, I turn 35 tomorrow. it's like, why are you still doing this? You know, like you should turn in the natty card. And it's like, no, like you don't get it. Like I find it stimulating. I find it like awesome to be able to crack the code and progress a little bit. Like that's why I do it. It's not to have this exterior necessarily. I mean, that's part of it, to like show off. It's more of, yeah, it's just, it's more of a mental game at this point.
Well, and just cause that 10 pounds isn't coming, I mean, there's not opportunities and a better Birdo coming. It just doesn't need to be like, I look like a genetic freak or it's not worth it.
You never made
that either or.
I'd like to think that, I mean, for a minute that I thought I was going to be running the rest of my life, even though I realized it, dude, you suck at this. I was like, you know what? I find it really fun to, you know, just lace up my shoes and go disappear and take a different route and just lose myself in running. I totally enjoy that. And like, I never broke the 5 minute mile. Like never. I think I like 5:07 or something. Jesus. Yeah. But I was like damn proud of that. Like to me, like I remember when like breaking 7 was like, it was painful, you know? Mm-hmm. So yeah, but again, it's like most people don't want to see it that way. And I think if they don't have that perspective, like whether you're a genetic freak or not, because sometimes there is genetic freaks that it's like, dude, hardly ever happens, but it does happen where it's like, dude, get your stuff together because you could be that good. Like, so yeah. Whether you're a genetic freak or not, like you're not getting the most enjoyment that you possibly could out of this if you're not going into it, I guess, expecting something necessarily or not wanting to get the most out of whatever it was that you were given naturally.
Yeah.
Yeah. And how many, you know, like league basketball players are out there that just enjoy playing in their local league, you know, and they practice and they kind of somewhat crack the code. They figure out, oh, well, you know what? I practice this over and over and over again. I'm going to try it in my next league game. And sure enough, it works. You know, I remember when my brother-in-law was playing in a league basketball game and he practiced this particular crossover move that he was telling me about. And guess what? It worked. And he scored like 8 points or something like that. And he was just jazzed about it. Yeah. But just because he's not going to make it up on the NBA, you know, platform, does that mean he's got to give it up? You know, that he can't pursue that anymore? No, he gets a lot of enjoyment, you know, out of cracking the code and doing his thing, you know, and just the local basketball level. And I'm sure that he's never accused Shaquille O'Neal of, or you know, Wilt Chamberlain of cheating.
Yeah. It's funny too, because the rebuttal to all that is like, is it worth it? I guess is the thing. Like, okay, well, say you guys are right, and say there are these genetic freaks, and if I'm not one, like you said, like your brother doesn't see it as, well, if I'm not NBA, it's not worth trying. And with the lifting thing, it's like you often find that if I'm not going to look like Berto, then it's not worth trying. But then I'd argue that, like, then just don't. Like, why you got to shit on everyone else's parade, though? I don't know.
See, like,
if you decided, I don't know. I just don't know if that's a good way to look at anything. Right? If I'm not going to be the 100% best, then I just don't want to do it at all. Then the sport, like, obviously won't work for you, though.
There's a lot of bodybuilders that are much more successful than I am on paper who've gotten, I guess you could say, if you look at their physique and my physique, they're in places that I haven't been to, likely may never be. And at this point, yeah, they've just had better careers overall. But I wouldn't, based on, like, I guess the standards within the sport, but I wouldn't trade places with them. Simply because, I guess, like the kids say, it's like, I stay woke and like I know where I stand and I know what I started with. And I get so much more out of the sport than they do, even though they probably don't see it that way themselves.
Yeah. That's a good point. It's like that adage where a lot of the most successful athletes don't make good coaches because they didn't know the struggle. Because it came so easy for them, you know? It's pretty common.
Yeah.
And that the most famous coaches are the ones that got pretty good, but either got injured or realized at some point, I'm not going to be that top 1% or whatever. So therefore, I'll, you know, take all, like, they had to grit their way to their top 25% in the world instead of the top one. And so, like, there's a lot you can still get from it. And like you said, I wouldn't trade my journey for everything, and I get a lot from it. I think that speaks to your respect for the sport, I guess. Then that's it too, right? Is like, am I am I respecting the things I get in return, or am I, like, I think I had an article written, like, your sport owes you nothing. Like, because it fucking doesn't. Like, like, it's not like I worked for 5 years, therefore I should look like this person at 5 years. It's like, well, then you'll never get what you want out of it. Mm-hmm. It gives you so much every day.
Yeah. If you choose to look at it that way, some people, and they're just doing it for the wrong reasons. That's what that is.
Yeah, do you think that the people that say so-and-so is cheating are actually even competitors giving it their best, or you think they're just like the armchair quarterbacks?
I think there's very few people, in fact. Sometimes I'll do it. Like, I'll do it. I'll, like, stoop on you. Like, if, you know, most of the time, often, like, they're, like, for example, with this kid, the 19-year-old stud we're talking about, I went to go look at a few of the people who were looking at, were commenting in a very negative way. And, you know, 80% of the time, there was no trail, right? But then when it was, it's like, dude, come on, bro. It's like you've been going at this for either like 10 months, you know, or like that squat was like an RPE like 3, like, you know, like it's like you're not really, you're just, it's not even worth it because you don't get it. You obviously don't get it. And I do feel that, yeah, and I've gotten to work with a lot of people who are like really, really like poor responders to stimulus, and especially the ones that work like really, really freaking hard. Like, they're the last people you will hear that from, because they are getting everything they can from their sport. You know, it might mean very little to no progress at times, even through the intermediate phases. But still, they're doing it for those right reasons, and they're getting a crap ton of it, and they can't help but see others doing the same and congratulating.
Yeah. How much or how often do you think, like, if someone's saying, oh, I'm not one of those freaks, whatever, and like we talked about how it takes a certain amount of work ethic or whatever and genetics, but at the same time, how many people do you think are actually missing the fundamentals that bad?
Ooh, yeah, I'd say the majority of people, to be honest. I think it's just a sport that doesn't make a living off the fundamentals. I mean, I just came back from the Arnold Expo, and they're not selling you the fundamentals. Like, there is no course there on, like, barbells with a booth, you know? Like, it's the exact opposite. It's, you know, like, here, like this bottle right here, you know, hook you up, you can skip a few steps, it's going to make it that much more efficient. So yeah, we just don't pride our, like, other sports is very different, you know, like in basketball, you can learn to pass, you can learn to dribble, you can learn to shoot, you can learn to use your left hand, you can learn the rules of the game. Whereas like with ours, there's no informal governing body that does that. There's just that tradition's just not rooted in what we do. And I do believe that a lot of the people who have these accusations, who accuse others of helping themselves out to some anabolics, they've missed out on, again, yeah, like thinking that way, having that perspective has you miss out on what you can get out of yourself. Because like instead of calling this person out, you can simply, it's like, okay, let me revamp what I'm doing. Let me make sure that just like this person, I am getting everything that I can out of myself. And that never, usually the way of thinking is like, well, you know, since obviously everyone is having like this juice party but me, I might as well go do that. And they miss out on a huge chunk of their development.
Yeah.
And there's those folks too, and I'm kind of beating a dead horse here, so forgive me if I am, but there's those folks that accuse Josh, is like, you know what, I've been lifting for 10 years. He's been lifting for 2. He's got to be cheating, you know, and that happens so often. But yet at the same time, we're so accepting of the fact that, you know what, I have practiced and practiced and practiced and practiced for years to dunk this basketball, and I'm getting closer and I'm getting better, but I still haven't been able to dunk the basketball. And then here comes that 6'5" kid that, like, on his very first try, boom, dunks the basketball, right? It's just the way God made him. You can't fight it. You can't deny that, you know, he didn't do anything to cheat. It's just the way that God made him. Josh, he's made for this sport, you know, and
probably other sports.
In my opinion, guys, you got to give him the benefit of the doubt. You know, yeah. You can't judge, point fingers, and everybody has proven. What is the saying? I almost said that wrong. You're innocent until proven guilty.
Well,
Andrea.
What?
No, this just reminds me. It's like, yeah, it's like you got to like realize you're short, like where you come up short, and you like that's what comparing yourself to others like should do for you. Like, so here's the story of genetics, right? So maybe actually who knows? Maybe you can confirm this for me. But like growing up, like me and my brother, we always grew up like in the barrios, you know, like it was just like Mexican galore, right? Uh-huh. And the Mexican girls, they used to always love the dudes with the like light colored eyes, like
yeah.
Right? Yeah. And like my brother, like he was blessed, like he has like the prettiest green eyes, right?
This
and
mother.
I wasn't blessed with that, so like my thing was like, okay, so how? Because I don't have that like that first impression. I don't have that pow upon coming up to a young lady and mm-hmm. and wanting her to know that I am available. What am I going to do? So I had to learn other ways, like to make up for it, you know. Mm-hmm. Like, and I'm sure Brad sees this. Like, there's probably kids on that football team that maybe they weren't blessed with like great speed, but they know how to position themselves and be at the right place at the right time, and that's how they make up for that. Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's just I think one of the perks of once you do realize that holy crap, like I'm missing this, I'm missing that. It's like okay, so here's your chance to like develop other things that you do have control over to make yourself. Better. And with my caca eyes, that's what I did. I definitely
That is true. I forget about that. It was the light skin or the like yellow olivey skin.
Yeah.
With the light eyes, yeah. Like them yellow bones.
I was trying to stay away from the sun and whatever it took. And he's sunblocking Nikes, Mama. You don't get it. You know?
Did you have a gold chain? Please tell me you wore a gold chain.
Gold. You give me too much credit.
The ones from the 25 cent machines that were just like plated plastic?
The 50 cent machine.
Oh, my bad.
2 quarters.
What you said, though, that makes me, or again, I'm going to beat that damn dead horse too, but a different one is when you said, Brad, well, I've been lifting for 10 years, and this person's been lifting for 2 and wide leg better than me. It's that just lifting can mean a lot of things. Like, going to the Y and doing some curls is different than, like, what, again, like, Nsema does or Cynthia does or, like, the other people that we've talked about. Like there's just dialing it in. It's funny that we're ending up talking about work ethic so much. It was the other topic we were considering talking about today, but it totally fits in this though. It's like, just cause you've been lifting for 10 years, could you've been missing the fundamentals that bad? Could you've been doing nothing but single plane machines when you could have been doing, you know, whatever. You could have been saying like, I did 15 reps. Whereas like your 15th rep was an RPE 8, you know? But I did what was in the book or I did what was on the website. So I should be looking the way that they do. And it's like, I think just because, when I train it, you know, when you train at different gyms, you see different lifters. And it's like, we've been doing this for a lot of years. So you can go to a 24-hour fitness and there's out of every 50 people in the weight room, there's going to be like 5 that look real good. That's just how it is.
Mm-hmm.
And you've seen that guy with the gloves and the basketball shorts and the scrunch socks that's there every day. They're every day, but he doesn't look any different than he did 5 years ago. You know what I mean? I know I shouldn't have said that. There's going to be someone with scrunch socks who's going to be mad. But
I wear scrunch socks. Just
okay.
So there we go.
With the gloves too, the fingerless gloves. Do you wear those?
I used to have the finger. That was like my first like nothing with them. Yeah. Yes. I had some. Yeah, I had some.
But you know what I mean? Like there's that one guy that's like between 50 and 70 years old that goes there every day and does the same damn thing. And look, granted, he's probably been going there for 20 years doing the same damn thing. And and then you'll have a kid that just attacks it.
Yeah. Unfortunately, that's usually the guy that says, oh, well, it works for me. I know my body and I know I can't do that and I can't do that and I can't do that. Oh, but he looks great, you know, and he can do that. So
tell you what, he's
cheating.
Yeah, I tell you what, there was a when I was in grad school, we did a study for GNC, and it was with the elderly. So it was like this certain part, it was like 50 to 70 year old adults, and they would have to, it was like three movements. They did leg press, bench press, and a dumbbell row, right? So they would come, oh God, every morning for like 6 months, I'd have to take these same people, and they would come, like they tested at the beginning, 6 months later they tested again, but in the middle every day they would do these three movements and a 30-minute walk while we watched them, and then they would go about their, they'd drink their drink and go about their day. So of course, I shouldn't have said the company, but to show the efficacy of this drink, right? And some of them were on placebo and some are, but because these people were not super trained, or maybe they'd just been that person, like these 50 to 70 year olds would make huge strength gains if they're on the placebo or not, just because like you still can. And it's just, you know, and it just blows my fucking mind when the 30 year old gives up. I'm just like, what? Mm-hmm. Yeah. There's just so much left. I mean, some of those dudes were like 65 years old, putting 30 pounds on their benches because they didn't bench before, or they didn't bench. Mm-hmm. They never did it for a test, or they never had a 20-year-old cheering them on every day, you know, mm-hmm. which is how we had that particular study. So it's like, I think I've just seen it so many times that it's so upsetting, because we've seen what you can do so late in life.
Yeah, that's a cool story, though. Genetics, and they overestimate their work ethic very well.
And underestimate practice, right? So like when I say put 30 pounds on their bench, they probably didn't bench before, and if they did, it was really light, and probably, you know, they didn't do it 3 days a week like we had them doing, to where you're just getting better at this thing. So man, and again, that's fundamentals, right? These people, whether you go to the gym every day or every other day or three times a week, like, are you fundamental one is, are you good at these movements, you know? Are you, I mean, we always say like bottom period is adherence, but not just adherence, like you show up every day, but adherence, like, are you giving yourself an opportunity to even get good at the shit that gets you looking the way that you mm-hmm. could look? Man.
See, we ended up pissed.
I know, I get real heated. Why do I do that? It's not even, we had this talk, right, where I'll do like a speech and Jeff's like, why are you mad? I'm like, I'm not mad. I'm just, I care. I just care, and I get louder when I care. It's annoying. Brad got more pissed than I did, though.
I think so.
I did. Yeah. Yes. I'm cursed.
I know. There's so many things to consider all the time, and I just want to make sure we consider all the things.
Yeah.
That's it.
Yeah, no, agree.
All right, I think we're ready for takeaways. What do y'all think?
Do you want go for some Chinese food?
That's takeout, Bert, that's different.
Oh.
Come on, get it together.
I think our takeaways are pretty obvious, to be honest with you.
All right, do them, Brad. Go.
I talked about them over and over again.
I know. We're probably annoying people with this one. But it's important, y'all. It's mm-hmm. important that you're not the bitter guy commenting on pictures that Berto's having to go look at and judge you.
Yeah. You don't want that for y'all. I do judge. I try not to, but I have to. It's how we get by.
Yeah. All right, Brad, give us the Chinese.
Like we said, I think that it's pretty obvious, you know, just don't judge because you don't have all the context. You don't have you don't know their life. You don't know their history. You don't know what they've done, you know? What else? You know, there is a certain amount of genetics that does, you know, play into whether or not, you know, you can excel in this arena, you know, in that arena. And just because you don't have those genetics doesn't mean that they are cheating. You know, what else? Bert, I'm going to hand you the baton and you start takeaways.
Well, I think I think we should say too, like, it's not like we've never been wrong about this either. Like, if we're, you know, being honest, there are some people that do the opposite, say they're natty or ignore Ooh, this is my people who dodge the question that that you look at their like it's obvious this isn't real life. Yeah, they won't admit it. Like we realize, like we're not so pro natty that we think everyone actually is. I think we should just say that.
There's definitely yeah.
There are cheaters, but it's like I think the accusation rate for our community, right? For people that we know are looking to be natural bodybuilders, at the rate at which these accusations come in is kind of absurd versus the other way that we've been talking about. Yeah. Okay, so give them the takeaways, Bert. Sorry.
No, I agree. That puts a bunch of people came to mind, and it's true. They are out there. That's what I'm just like, come on, dude. It's like
we all know. Come on.
Just don't label yourself that.
Set yourself free. Yeah.
Ooh. I guess no. When I think of this, I think of I guess the three pillars, right? It's going to how are you going to get the most out of yourself? Like, what are things to take into consideration? That's going to be like definitely like genetics. Like, you know, I'm not going to try to join the NBA anytime soon. And at a very early age, I kind of knew that. So genetics, work ethic, and then perspective. And if you marry those three, you know, whether you're a high responder, a low responder, you know, be aware of where you're at. Use that scale to, you know, judge where you're at and how well you are doing. And then just like get to fucking work.
Boom.
And you'll be cool.
Yeah.
Thanks so much for listening, guys. 3DMJ prides itself on keeping this show, our blog, and our YouTube channel as free and relevant sources of information for our community week after week. We also release additional free video courses as often as possible at 3DMJVault.com. If you'd like to help support our mission and our work, please consider becoming a monthly patron of our endeavors. Go to patreon.com/team3DMJ and donate as little as $1 per month to our cause of helping educate and grow the drug-free bodybuilding and powerlifting communities worldwide. You can definitely choose to donate more, and if you do so, we'll send you discount codes for future use on any of our paid products. But any little bit helps, and we appreciate your monthly support in any amount that you see fit. So again, you can start assisting the team at patreon.com/team3DMJ. That's patreon.com/team3DMJ. Thanks for sticking around, and we'll see you in the next show.